Hello everyone, this is your professor Tei Wei Wang. This lecture is a summary of your Chapter 2, Identifying Opportunities for Business Transformation with IT. IT transformation is a very old research topic in the MIS field. This chapter has been put at the very beginning of the textbook because it identifies the role of information technology in all business operation. In other words, we are trying to find out the purpose of why we are using information technology in business. The topic of system analysis and design is about software development. So the alternative question to ask is, how can we use development process to support business strategy or operation? Before we get into the content of chapter number 2, I would like to present you a note that I took a few years ago. This is the lecture notes that we used to facilitate the discussion in our online on-campus class. We usually spend about 1 hour to 2 hours just to discuss and debate on the definition of analysis and design, which are the two most important words in our course. In this lecture, I would like to just present you with a conclusion of our discussion. There are three key phrases that we identify as the essence features that if you want to understand what to do in the process of analysis and design. The first one is the purpose of analysis. Analysis is a task that we perform as either a business person or as an information technology worker, that we try to do something about the current situation, and the ultimate goal is to identify problems. The corresponding question is, how do we identify the problem? The answer also falls under the definition of analysis. That is, two other phrases. One is detail-oriented, the other is breakdown. Essentially, analysis is to break down the system using some kind of a concept or framework or a method or a process or tool. And during the process of systematically break down the system, that we identify detail, identify the root cause in a way that during the process we get a sense and feeling about what's the root problem of the situation we are facing. So the task of breaking down a certain situation become the central of all the discussion that we have in this course. This include user requirement analysis, include the modeling, include the testing, include everything that we do prototyping. All these things are trying to use some sort of a method or mechanism, try to get into the details or a deeper understanding of the situation. And in business operation, usually we have this top-down concept of long-term business strategy, middle-term business tactic, and the short-term business operation mentality. Therefore, a lot of these techniques and method that we use in analysis and design follow these mentality. And this chapter starts with a very top-level business strategy level to start thinking about how can we break down the business strategy to identify potential problem and benefit that we may encounter when we are using the information technology. So at the very top level, everything that we do in using technology, software in particular, to facilitate business coming from the top, and we have to achieve the very top goal of business operation. And the assumption is that we are doing a for-profit organization. Now, of course, if you are dealing with a non-for-profit organization, the primary method or objective will change. But you can probably extend the concept of called the revenue to, say, in a non-for-profit will be overall well-being, and that will fit into the formula as well. So very simply, use a layman's term, increase revenue, cut on costs, and make sure you're competitive. That is the main three objectives to make sure business can continue to operate. Therefore, everything we do in software development, system and design, have to follow the three big big goals when you are doing everything in the process. As I mentioned earlier, IT-enabled transformation in business is a very old MIS research topic. This has been around not only in the MIS field, but also in the management and economics field for at least 30 years. It's actually more than that. It's probably 40 to 50 years in the process of academic research. And your textbook presents you with three bullet points or so to give you an example of what are the discipline or the thinking or concept that many authors and the researchers present in the past 30 years. Many popular buzzwords used in business are also in this category. For example, e-commerce, knowledge management, business intelligence, or even the hottest topic we have, artificial intelligence-enabled business. All these related to the same topic about organization change through technology. Let me give you two examples of such transformation through information technology. One is when in my earlier career of teaching, we went through the process of so-called e-commerce transformation. And e-commerce was a very big invention or revolution, you can call that, to change the whole world supply chain and business operation. And nowadays, we are experiencing the process of artificial intelligence-induced transformation. This includes whatever you do when you purchase anything on Amazon, when they recommend the product to you, or when you are trying to or thinking about buying a Tesla self-automation driving car. All these will change the business and the environment a lot. However, looking at the IT-enabled transformation is a very big topic. And for a regular person like us to approach this problem, it's probably easier to look at this problem from a different level. So this is what we also talked about earlier in a few minutes ago, different levels of business operation. This can relate to if you see a new technology, will that change your business model? We have witnessed already the transformation of retail from the large, big retail company bankruptcy in the past few years, and everybody moved to a semi-hybrid model of online on-ground shopping, and this includes Amazon and Walmart. Along the same line, impact the business strategy, impact the tactic of every middle-term operation. Finally, that we have this day-to-day operation level. The role of software in most of the entry-level position, or for most of us going to a IT organization or IT department, that you'll be doing job more on a day-to-day basis, not at the CIO level, then you're focused more on the operation. The honestly speaking, the methodology we are seeing in this textbook will majorly focus on the operation level. That is, we are trying to go through the methodology process so we can come up with the IT solutions or software that is suitable for improving or re-engineering day-to-day operation. How does day-to-day operation and the selection of software and technology link to the overall top strategy, business strategy, and technology strategy? That will be left to the discussion of other course, such as business process analysis or enterprise information system. In this course, we will spend most of the time, including our assignment and our discussion, on the tactics and the operation level system improvement. So during our discussion, I'll try to reflect this over and over again, but there is one keyword that we have to remember, that is scaled. Whenever we are dealing with a problem, we have to look at the scale of the problem and use our method and strategy accordingly. And these three keywords on the framework of figure 2.3, Portfolio, program, and teams are generally used in IT project management. Simply saying, each team in a IT-enabled project is try to engage on one project at a time. So a few projects put together has a more technical level impact will be considered a program. And if you go into the other software, project management software like Microsoft Project, you will see that at a higher level, a few programs put together, see a CRM program, ERP program, or customized mobile app program. Put all these together, become your business IT portfolio, and that portfolio has an impact at strategy level. So what is not present on the slide here is that portfolio, IT portfolio, a combination of different IT programs together, is actually a design effort at the IT strategy level. And a program, IT program, that a few projects put together become a program that is existing at the technical middle management level. And finally, each team, IT improvement team, or software development team operate at the operational level, create a solution that can be used immediately a week after another. Usually that the timeline is 1 week, 1 month, then we deliver the solution as a small project in the organization to improve the business operation. Or sometimes it's to support business operation or support the change of a business operation. To understand the business goals and operation at a different level, strategy, the tactic, and the operational level, the typical management practice is to build business model. In particularly, that we are building so-called the business process model. In a more general term, you are building a flowchart at a different level. Higher level flowchart, middle level flowchart, or detailed operational level flowchart. So usually in business analysis and design or information system analysis and design, the first thing we learn is try to be a better process analyst. So a person who can analyze business process in a better way. So what is a better way to analyze business process? Building a more formal models, and the so-called formal model is that you have to build a flowchart not just to represent whatever you try to represent, but it should be also serve as a tool that you can use to do diagnosis and to do problem analysis to perform some sort of improvement. If there is no foundation of the process model to help you support the such goal improvement, then it will not be a good process analysis. Before a good strategy or process or framework that we use to analyze the business process can be discussed, let us start by looking at the purpose of business process analysis. This includes discovery of finding new things and new problems in the business organization, and structuring, come up with some sort of a higher level, middle level structure to present your finding to understand the system better. And finally, identify opportunity for transformation. To achieve this goal, we're going to be adopting three main tools, modeling tool, three different diagrams in helping you understand how do we identify new problem, how do we structure the situation, how do we transform the current situation. And these three tools will be the activity diagram from the UML world, the use case modeling from the UML world, and finally, data flow diagram that is from a more traditional IBM age, the system analysis method. So three different type of diagram we're going to be using in doing business analysis. Each one of the diagram has its benefit and disadvantage. We will discuss each one of them when we are encountering them in our textbook as well as in our assignment. In this particular chapter, we will introduce the first tool, that is the activity diagram. Activity diagram is one of the nine standard UML diagram that used by the IT professional. And UML stands for Unified Modeling Language. From the name, it implied that this is a language that the founding organization was trying to standardize or unify the language that we use in this particular case, graphical language we use to communicate with each other in the information system world. And this particular diagram called activity diagram is actually very simple. Most of you will be able to do a good job with some 1 hour training from this particular course. The notation used in this diagram are also very similar to flowchart, but there are a few big differences. First of all, for most of the flowchart diagram, the rectangle shape, like what you see on the right-hand side, labeled object, is usually used to represent process. On the other hand, or process or activity or a task or job, and or you know, all these are, or you know, in the way, the same words that to represent the concept or process or step. Object, however, in activity diagram, a rectangle is representing an object. Very strictly speaking, the notation on this slide is not 100% correct from the UML standard. As you can probably see that the rectangle in our slide here has, or actually all the shape here, has a little bit shadows behind the rectangle. This is actually, I would not say mistake, it's not the best practice to it, because usually when we see a shadow, later we'll introduce, it does not represent an object. It represents a group of objects, represent a concept what we call class. But in this particular case, it represents actually an object. And the process or step or job or task, on the other hand, is represented by this rounded rectangle. And of course, we have this arrowhead line represent the direction of movement, the change from time, one time period to another. And we also have this, the more like a diamond shape notation to represent decision. All these are very similar to your flowchart. Now, in addition to the regular flowchart concept that involved in the activity diagram, we also have this thing called a fork and join. Fork and joins are synchronous tools in activity diagram. This is something that regular flowchart does not have. And in the way, the synchronization bar, called a fork or join, create a better mechanism for the activity diagram to control timing. So you can actually specify when almost exactly when a certain thing will happen, and when a certain thing have to wait until other tasks have been complete to continue. So using this notation, that you can very quickly start drawing a flowchart like activity diagram. And activity diagram is usually going from left to the right or from top to the bottom to represent the flow of the time. There are two important features I would like to draw your attention to. You look at all these processes or steps in the flow or activity diagram. There are, say for example, one, the first one say enter store, second one say get charge or basket. I would like to kind of draw your attention to how you write these activities. First of all, each one of this activity does not have a subject. Say for example, you in the first step, you will not say customer enter the store. So you ignore the subject. Second, all these steps or tasks are represented using a verb phrase, and simple verb phrase, usually no more than four words. Right? If you have too many words in a flowchart, you probably can feel it's very kind of redundant and detail-oriented, too much detail. A lot of time, too many words in the diagram, it makes people hate to read the diagram. So using a naming convention, that is one, no subject, two, using a simple verb phrase, to represent each single activity in the activity diagram is a best practice. Some activity diagram will include a beginning and end states. Those does not increase too much readability problem. You can easily understand when and where the process will start and end. But a lot of time, a lot of process we are analyzing does not have a very clear starting and ending state. And in that particular situation, that we usually leave it open and try to focus on the scope or sort of scope that we are trying to study and analyze. So process or activity diagram like this one present a very important process logic we call the step-by-step or sequential logic. So step one, step two, step three. So we have a sequential logic easily represented by an activity diagram or a flowchart, right? As you probably can see, I use a activity and a diagram and flowchart kind of like a back and forth, but the official name should be activity diagram because the notation we use is activity diagram notation. And all the flowchart has the second logical component other than the step-by-step sequential logic, that is the decision logic. The process should give you an alternative or selection of certain decision during some change in situation. In this case, that the decision is represented by this diamond shape row. So you can, with this diamond shape, if something happened, then do this. If this is yes or no, the other way around, or option. Sometimes you have 1, 2, 3, 4 different options. Once you have this decision logic involved, you can easily create many complicated business process in the analysis process. And one of the subtle, what do you call this, the feature that in activity diagram, it does not mention very specially in your textbook, is that activity diagram does not go backward. What does that mean? Usually the process will not go from left to the right. So if you see all the arrowhead, it will not go back, return to the previous step. It's usually go from the timeline, go, you know, straight to from left to right. And if it's go from top to the bottom, you will not go from bottom to top. So if you have any arrowhead going backward, that is usually a sign of a problem, right? And, you know, when we are doing analysis, when we see a sign of problem, that is where we have to pay more attention. So make sure when you are drawing these diagrams, try to follow the direction of the arrow, left to right, top to the bottom. If you identify a situation, you are urged, you have this desire to return to previous stage, be very careful. And when we encounter that situation, we will spend a little bit of time talking about that. That is usually an opportunity for improvement or opportunity for IT transformation. So on this particular slide, I put three important notes here already. First of all, each activity should be named without a subject and use a simple verb phrase to name the process. The third is that arrow lines or arrows does not go backward, right? So make sure that you pay attention to the process that may have arrow going backward. And I know that many of you will feel the urge to put a subject on the process, and there is an alternative way to represent this particular concept. So your slide on figure 2.9 show that you can actually put a nose there and put a parenthesis, putting a name, and you can put a class name or object name, kind of using the UML terminology without explaining it, but you know that is a practice you can use. But this is not the best practice, so I will not recommend using this method to represent the subject or the person or object that is performing the job in your process. Again, emphasizing putting actor roles or the subject name on your activity is not a recommended practice in UML notation. Next, let's introduce this concept called the fork and join. Fork and join are the concept that to control the synchronization of your business process. The fork and the joins are the playing the role that in our operation management, you probably have learned the two project management methods called the PERT and CPM, critical path method and performance evaluation and review technique. These two methods has the concept of precedence analysis. This precedence analysis is actually playing the role of fork and join here in the activity diagram. So the concept of fork create parallel process that can be performed simultaneously together in a project. And the concept of join create this sufficient condition, or the everybody have to wait until other people have completed the job before you can move on to the next step. So these two can be draw in your program logic to control the timing of the process. So in addition to the sequential logic that present in the activity diagram and decision logic also in this diagram as well, we also learn a new logic. This is called the parallel processing logic. So in larger project or in a more complicated project, some of the tasks can be performed parallelly or simultaneously, and that is identified as a potential situation that you can speed up the completion of your project or process. And the decision logic can be also used as something what we call the merge operation. So the parallel path from multiple sources can be merged into one decision notation and then move on to the next step of the process. This does not create additional, it's called a logic component in the process logic description. And just a moment ago, I mentioned that adding the subject into the activity is not a good practice. A better practice, a good practice in UML activity diagram is instead of putting the subject into the activity, it's better to put something what we call the swim lane to represent different object is performing different job. So on this particular diagram, you see that there are three players or three object interact with each other to perform the business process that described earlier that we tried to look like some sort of a purchasing behavior. Customer go in and do something, interact with the cashier, and then exit the store. That the entire process is described by the concept called swim lane. Now, correspondingly, in the flow chart, the swim lane type of a diagram is usually called a cross-functional flow chart. So cross-functional flowchart is a recommended diagram method for you to draw when you are using a UML activity diagram. The only disadvantage of a cross-functional or so-called swim lane enabled activity diagram is that it usually takes a little bit more space. You know, as you can probably see, that two out of the three swim lane on this particular diagram are pretty empty. So your space will be very much wasted. But however, the major advantage you gain here is something we will talk about more in the future, is that the clarity of responsibility assignment. Responsibility, that is a keyword. So how do you assign responsibility to either software or user in the business process? That responsibility analysis is one of the things that we gain mainly from using a cross-functional flowchart or a swim lane-enabled activity diagram. Some of the process will be repeated multiple times, and this is also one of the components in the process logic. So we have mentioned so far sequential logic, decision logic, parallel processing logic, and here we see another one. It's called iteration logic. Sometimes in programming language, we call this looping or repetition logic. In activity diagram, we can use this add-on notation to represent the iteration or repetition. Sometimes it can also be represented by using the combination of a decision logic or this the diamond shape to going back and forth to create a iteration. But the benefit of using this iteration notation here in activity diagram is using this notation, you will not see the arrowhead going backward. So if you're using a diamond to represent a repetition, then it's unavoidable the arrow will go backward, which violate one of our main best practice or principle in activity diagram. Arrows does not go backward, right? So using this notation here, showing the red box, is probably a preferred way to represent repetition. Now, when we reach this point, we have also already discussed all the standard notation for activity diagram. So these are this standard notation this defined in the UML standard, UML 2.0. And the next few slides on your textbook actually talk about something that people use quite often. It's not the orthodox ways of using activity diagram, but again, the language, UML, Universal Modeling Language, Unified Modeling Language, that is, language sometimes will be used in the wrong grammars or differently when you move the language to different scenario. So the following few slides present you with the activity diagram blending with the object diagram and showing additional concept. Now, this additional concept is something that we will talk about in our next few lecture to describe the three basic components of information system analysis. The three components of analysis are the process, so we study business process, data, we study data used in the process, and also we study interface, user interface or system interface in the process. In the activity diagram, especially the swim lane enabled activity diagram here, we see two major component analysis component has been present in this diagram. Swim lane represent interface. So when you cross the swim lane, you have interface. When you go through the process or logic, you're describing the process of the information system. Only thing missing here is data. Traditional or classic UML activity diagram does not describe data specifically in the diagram. However, some people like to include additional notation in the activity diagram to represent the concept, in particular data. And also, they also represent some sort of events-driven concept in the activity diagram. So these data and events introduce additional four notation here. And in my lecture, I would recommend not to use them too much. The data is probably the only one you can use in activity diagram. The rest of them I would not recommend. But you know, there are people using them, so let's take a look at how they are used. This activity diagram shows that we have amount and customer payment and change to customer. So crossing between customers and the cashier to represent the data that has been generated in the process. Again, this is not recommended, but people are doing that. And these data component can be seen very often in the flowchart. Flowchart using a hard drive or data store to represent this type of concept. It's not recommended, but some people are using it. The other kind of discrepancy of the activity diagram you're seeing in figure 2.15 is that you see there are a couple of dashed lines going backward. See that the backward pointing direction and upward pointing direction. It's again not recommended, but they have some important message they want to deliver. So instead of using a solid line, they use a dashed line. Say, oh yeah, there's something. A data need to be sort of processed and saved somewhere. We cannot represent them in a regular activity diagram, so we put a dashed line and a data store notation in there. And so does some of the called the events notation. So this this oval shape that you can see, this I don't know how to describe that anymore, but those are the external events that actually go beyond the current process we are analyzing. It can be a process triggered by the existing process, or a process starting the process in our system here, or some sort of a time sensitive event that triggers certain thing or pause certain process in our operation. So there you go, you have learned the UML activity diagram, even though you have not tried to draw one yet, or maybe you have experience before. But if you have not tried to do that, you will have opportunity to do so in our assignment. To summarize, I would like to present you with a couple of things in addition to the three best practices in activity diagram. That is that when we are analyzing the business process and try to pay attention to the following two categories. One is that you need to know what kind of logic you are dealing with, right? So there are four logic we identified today in the example: sequential logic, decision logic, parallel logic, and repetition logic. Among these four, the activity diagram can pretty much represent them very well. The second category are the component for system breakdown. So in other words, this is probably the first lesson of system analysis I want to teach you. That is, whenever we see an information system, the one of the first things you can do in problem solving or troubleshooting process is try to divide your system into three different parts. Process is that a problem of the process you are doing wrongly, or is that data, is something wrong with the data? It could be a data moving around, or data storage missing, or data quality problem. Or third, would that be a user interface or system interface? I try to avoid using user interface, because interface can be between not only user but also between system as well. So think in that three directions and will help you become a more systematic problem solver and a better system analyst or business analyst in the field of IT professional. So that will be the summary or highlight of your chapter number 2. I will talk to you in another exciting lecture soon.